Every generation has its own group of people who march to the beat of a different drummer. In the 50s, it was the beatniks. In the 60s, it was the hippies. Today, it is the punk rockers. Now, I guess we've all seen them at one time or another. The spiked orange hair, the lethal-looking jewelry, lots of leather. This morning, we've invited five punk rockers to come here and explain and tell us why they are the way they are. And we'll get started with that in just a moment. All right, let me introduce our punk rockers to you today. This is Natalie sitting next to me, born and raised here in New York City, graduated from the Hewitt School for Girls on the Upper East Side, currently a junior at NYU. A boyfriend is the leader of the band Murphy's Law. His name is Jimmy Gestapo, and you just waved to Jimmy,
yeah,
right? Jimmy's in Astoria right now. Okay. Next to her is Todd, who is 16 years old, born in New York City, been in the hardcore scene since he was 11 years old, 15 months in reform school, it says here, Todd. Plays guitar for the band The Warzone, a junior high school dropout. Christine, next to him, attending Pratt Institute in Brooklyn, been into the punk scene for 6 years. She's about 21 years of age. Ray, one of the more outspoken members of the punk underground here in New York, been in and out of a lot of bands, around 21 years of age. And next to him is Debbie from Canada, left there when she was 13, currently writes a fan magazine for punks. Okay, now look, we've all seen, you know, the punks around town. I want to know why you chose this lifestyle. Let's start with you, Natalie. Why?
Why not?
No, I mean, other than that.
Well, I mean, everybody's into their own thing. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, there's some people are into heavy metal. Some people are into being junior executives. We're into this just because this scene gives you the opportunity to be an individual. And you get to say what you want to say and do what you want to do. And if anyone disagrees with you, they can come up to your face and tell you so.
But Debbie, you know, when they write about it, the writers always say this was born out of a frustration that you guys had somewhere along the way with your parents, with your family, with Suburban.
I don't know. These experts keep writing all these stupid books and having these stupid talk shows.
And making lots of money.
Like Phil Donahue had this ridiculous show on. I'm sorry, Phil, but you really blow. And all he did was put words in our mouths. He kept coming up and going, "You hate your parents, right? You hate your parents. You're all fascist Nazis, right? Right?" And we're like, "Where are you getting this from, Phil?"
Well, he's getting it from the same place we get it from, what we read about.
Well, where do you read these things?
New York Magazine for one. Okay, let's start with that. That was just out a couple months ago.
Peter Blounder should not be allowed to write for Bazooka Bubblegum Comics. Guy's completely incompetent journalist.
Well, then tell me where it comes from, because it is kind of an eccentric way of
life. You know what it is? These people get these ideas, all right, we're going to do this great story on this, like, bizarre cult, right? And they go down to bars, and they eavesdrop in on conversations, and then they don't even print the whole truth. What they do is pick the most sensational,
they,
you know, stories. Sex, drugs, orgies, you know.
Do.
I mean, like, the whole article is supposed to be on the music scene, and he ends up writing about my sex life. Who cares about my sex life?
I do!
Oh,
but you know, in the 50s, the beatniks, even though it's like you're revolting against something, perhaps, there still is a conformity. You can see that you all basically have things in common. You do look alike. How can you say that it's an individual expression when there truly are, your hair is basically the same and you have tattoos and things?
I don't have any tattoos.
Well, but it's obvious meeting that.
I don't think I look like Debbie, and I don't think I look
But it's the same way you guys all think,
but
that you're all
you guys look a lot more alike than we do.
But you all look like something else.
That's what I'm saying. Yeah. Is there any difference? We all look alike, and you all look alike.
Well, we're more like a family.
Yeah.
You see, we look out
for
each
other. We all like each other.
I've been taking care of my
hair
for like 5 years, and like it's like my brother, you know? And I don't even, if I didn't know her, and I saw her in the street, and just because she's into punk or hardcore, and she was like, you know, need some food or something, I just buy for her because we're like a big family. You don't find that in like heavy metal and a lot of other kinds of music. Most of them are into drugs and like destruction and stuff. We're not into that. Like, we all like look out for one another.
What exactly are you into? Would you say hardcore?
Well, see, like,
it's getting so cliche. Hardcore.
Yeah, hardcore. Yeah. It gets like, you know,
it's another label.
We don't want to be labeled, you know, we don't want to be, there's all these scenes like the yuppies, the preppies, the japs, the heavy metal kids, you know, we all ended up getting labeled because people have, in society, they have to classify you, they have to put you in a category because they have to explain you. Mm-hmm. If they can't explain you, then people start getting nervous. What are these kids up to? What's going on with them?
All right, now do you go to NYU dressed like that?
Yes.
You do?
Yes, I do.
What about your parents? How do they feel about this? How does your family feel about it?
My mother loves
him. My mother's very supportive.
It's up to me.
She respects my opinions as an individual. She thinks I can think for myself, and she knows if I have to do this, then I have to do this.
Do you have a job?
I have three jobs.
What do you do?
I go to school full-time. I'm a part-time studio assistant for Spiderweb Studios. I'm a part-time assistant for an artist on 24th Street. I work in the school library at Pratt Institute. I'm a fine arts major full-time at Pratt.
Now, Christine,
I'm putting myself
are you
school,
dressed the way you dress when you go to these jobs, or are you dressed for us the way you dress at night?
Since I've been in New York, I dress the way that I want to. Before I moved down here, it was a lot harder. I tried to tone it down a little bit, but, you know, it really got me angry to have to do that because I'm a very competent person. I can work as well or better than anyone that dresses conservatively or straight. And that doesn't really have anything to do with job performance.
So you're not rebelling against anybody. You just chose this.
I'm just doing what I want to do.
You're doing what you want to do. We'll pause. We'll come right back in a moment.
Get with your friends and turn on an hour of big box and tough trivia with New York's number one fun. Sale of the Century at 4, Jeopardy at 4:30, today on Channel 7.
Play School presents Mother's Minutes with Joan London.
The other day, my two-year-old...
Okay, we're talking about the punk scene today. We have five young people with us today, and we're trying to find out about it. Now, Kathy brought up a good point. During the break, are these fights that break out in the places and the clubs that the bands are playing at? Does the music motivate all of that?
No, that's ridiculous.
See, for me, it's like I'll be watching a band play, like when the Cro-Mags played the last show that they played. You know, it's like that music just made me move. You know, it just made me start going off. Then you got guys, you know, who come down and like, oh, slam dancing, you know, and they just go around punching people, just going around going bam and just punching people, and it's not. You could just tell it's not. You know,
they don't
the
mean
music. That's making a move.
I mean,
there's
fights in every single club. You go to Palladium, and I mean, I have seen this at Palladium. These guys in Gucci suits start
brawling. Yeah, but isn't fighting a part of the scene?
No, fighting is not a part of the scene. The only difference with our scene is that we're more honest. If you have some kind of beef with somebody, you go up to them, you try to discuss it. If they don't want to talk about it, you know, maybe it comes to blows, but I think that's a lot better than walking around me, behind each other's backs all the time, which is what other people do.
It's basically sticking up for yourself.
That's all. You're just defending
saying,
your
don't
rights.
Tread on me. All right.
Where did you sleep last night?
I didn't go to sleep last night. Me and him just hung out after we got off work.
None of us saw.
Where are you going to sleep tonight?
At home at our apartment on Ludlow Street.
You guys share an apartment together?
Yeah.
How many people in that apartment?
Just me, him, and our Pitbull Chiba.
A what? Oh,
Pitbull.
Pitbull.
Oh, the Pitbull Chiba.
Yeah, I thought that was another band.
To watch our band. To watch our band equipment.
You what?
To watch our band equipment.
Because our neighborhood isn't the best neighborhood.
Low East Side. It's not really
tough out there.
Yeah.
So now, what about sex and drugs? Are you guys all into that?
Sex.
No drugs in the scene?
No.
Us?
It just deteriorates what you want to do. It diversifies everything. That's why our music says something, because a lot of other music, you know, throughout
people
the 60s or whatever, it just, you go lose track, you know, what you want to do. Like, I guess, sort of like with the hippies, what they wanted peace and everything, but they all did so many drugs. You know, they just lost track after a while.
You never had a marijuana cigarette, is that what you're telling me?
No, I tried, yeah. I'm not saying I didn't, but then, you know, within myself, I learned that I wasn't going to go nowhere if I did that. Mm-hmm. I haven't drank in 10 months. I don't have to touch anything no more.
Well, see, it looks like we got you guys all wrong then, right?
Yeah,
I mean, the public has a misconception about...
Well, when the public doesn't understand something, they try to... They either just try to destroy it, or they try to give it a symbol, a label, so no one understands it, and, you know, turn against
politically,
it.
Everybody tries to make
everything black
and white.
I could ask you about the future. How do you see yourselves growing up into adulthood, and do you see yourselves getting married and having children and living in society and
going
to the bank?
Yeah.
It might not ever even come.
You really can't worry yourself.
Nothing ever works out the way you plan anyway.
But don't you want to marry Jimmy Gestapo and have little Gestapos?
Start a little camp in Queens.
But really, don't you want to get married someday?
I can't really think about it. I'm 20 years old. You know, my goals in life is not to get married.
What is your goal?
Do dishes for the rest of my life.
Well, what is your goal?
Gee, it is mine.
No. Well, I like your ring. You guys see this ring?
What is your goal?
My goal in life? I guess my goal is really just to be happy in any way I can.
Well, you're going to NYU. You're studying something.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I want to be, you know, I'm not going to, like, lie and say I'm into this poverty trip, because I'm definitely not, you know. Mm-hmm. I want to have money.
Politically, where would you say you are?
Everybody's different.
Everyone's got their own beliefs, just like everyone out here. Everyone's going to have their own beliefs.
We're all individuals, you know. You can't sit here and say, yeah, we're all one thing, because everyone here has five different opinions.
I doubt they're Republicans.
Mm.
I would like to clear up.
As a matter of fact,
the
group
Jimmy's
has
a registered Republican.
No, as a matter of fact, the group, if we can call it a group, has been called a conservative, radical right?
Well, Phil Donahue wants you to think that we're all fascists, yeah, you know, Sig Heil, yeah. Sig Heil, Phil.
A lot of us, what we try to do, I can't speak for everybody, but a general idea I got, you know, is that we're like all American. If when you get into right wing and left wing, you get into politics and you'll always argue that point. Yeah. I mean, a lot of us, I think, are proud to live in America because being communist is really downhill. You go nowhere being into communism.
All right, we have a psychologist, Joy Brown from WABC Radio, who is going to come out here and give us her analysis of this whole movement, okay? We'll see if she's right, according to you. Right back to Punker, Jennifer, who has come wandered in here a little bit late,
you
but nice
punker.
To have you
all. Well, I brought Jennifer in, and she was sitting out in the green room saying, where my mother will never see me.
Something and this, of course, is Joy Brown from WABC. Yes.
Something I'd like to clear up is, like, punk rock is like, pretty much died out, you know, it's just hardcore
they
now.
They all OD'd.
And, you know, I'm not a punk, I'm a skinhead, and there's, like, a real big difference
what
between
difference?
Punks and skinheads. Well, skinheads are, there's like, it seems to be more unity with skinheads, like stick together a lot more.
They're bald.
Mm-hmm. that's one thing.
Okay, so you're a skinhead. You're not a skinhead, are you?
No way.
Well, what are you? Are you a punker?
I'm just me.
Just you. All right, fine. Okay, Joy, what is your analysis of all this?
Well, first of all, I think, as you said in the opening segment, that every group of kids, when they're not children anymore, need to say we're different than our parents. I think that's part of growing up in this society. For some of us, it was miniskirts and the boys wore long hair. We wore no makeup. These kids have enough makeup to last a lifetime for those kids who are hippies. And I think that's the point. I asked the audience, how do you feel about these kids? They said, why do they have to dress that way? And I think one of you said it. It's because you can then recognize each other. You can say, see, we're all similar. We believe similar things. We can hang out together, because that's part of adolescence, to feel like you belong. You're no longer a kid. You really don't want to be like your parents when you're in your mid to late teens and early 20s. These kids are basically, they're telling you they're not on drugs. Most of them are in school. A lot of them work. They like each other. So if they look a little
weird. Are
they
rebelling against anything?
Sure. What are you rebelling against?
Ugly clothing.
Ugly clothing.
One thing I'd like
stop
to
looking up way I'm dressed.
Well, they're rebelling. They're rebelling. Look, if you have no power, and the people who have power dress and look a certain way, what you want to say is nanner, nanner, because you're not going to be part of that structure, at least for a while. And I think the obvious way of saying, look, I matter, I'm important, I'm an individual, is to dress and look differently, because otherwise you're playing on somebody else's
yeah,
court.
Yeah, but any jerk and you can get dressed up like this. That doesn't mean anything.
It's an attitude. It's my head.
I mean, there's so many people that come in from suburbia, not to put suburbia down, but a lot of kids come in as soon as it gets warm enough to sleep in the city. And they dress up like this, and they don't last a week.
Can you be a punker and look like Kathy?
There's plenty of our friends.
Kathy is a
well, not dressed
punker.
Like Kathy, but I mean, if she's put on a pair of sneakers and like jeans and a T-shirt, she can hang out with us. We're not into this dress code.
Yeah,
deal.
Joy.
Yeah, Joy.
So there, nanner, nanner. Listen, you said the kids don't last a week. What is lasting mean, and
New
what
York
is not lasting?
Because New York City's a hard place to make it.
When you don't,
what happens
nanner,
to
when you, yeah,
they
what?
Get beat up, they get scared, they go home.
It's like hardcore is a lifestyle, man. It's something
yeah, it's not a costume. It's not a joke. We don't do this.
If you had to describe in a sentence what hardcore
being
is,
honest.
What would you tell me? Being honest.
Being honest.
Doing but what you
can't
want
just,
to do.
What is being honest? You can't just dress up and put on a costume. You know, what's his name? Phil Donahue kept saying it's a costume. It's not a costume. It's a way of life.
All
it's the way
of us
we
wear
think.
Costumes.
This is
it's a way
act.
Of identifying. I just think you can be honest without stepping on someone else's turf, don't you? Do you have to be violent to be honest?
Well, if somebody comes in, like...
What's stepping on someone else's turf?
When you say that people don't last for more than a week because they get beat up.
Because they can't. They're not smart enough to get a job. They got nowhere to live. Sleeping in the street in New York is not a safe thing to do.
No, it's not at all.
And they're giving punkers a bad name.
That's right.
So there.
Are you talking about being violent? Like, at our shows, when we have hardcore shows, we don't have big bouncers, like, doing stuff. We keep our own.
Dr. J. Adlersberg.
And the fall season's newest romantic duo, Shelley Hack and Tom Mason.
And the great actress, Talia Shire, of course, Rocky's wife. Joy, thank you very much. Jennifer, everybody here, thank you so much for coming by and being honest with us. And we hope you'll come back again, okay?
Sure. Anytime.
All right, big guy.
Lips.
All right.
There, small, small, small.